I am back, and you are comfortably zoned with me, the Zigzag Man, in Alameda, California, right across the bay from San Francisco, and across the moat from Oakland. I'm in California, but as you know, my heart is in New York, especially with the New York Mets, and I have a special show today, because we're going to honor the 1973 National League champions. To do that, I have historians from the Comfortably Zone Network, Robert Cole, Marty Rose, and Jeff Kalman, to help me wax poetic about that team. And I hope you enjoy it. It's one of my favorite episodes ever. And buckle up, enjoy, and remain comfortably zoned. Thank you very much. I am back, as promised, to talk a little baseball, Met baseball in particular, with three baseball historians and members of the Comfortably Zoned Network. They are Robert Cole. How are you, Robert?
Doing well, Ralph. Thank you.
Good. Marty Rose is here. How you doing, Mert?
I'm doing fine. Thank you, Ralph.
Good. And Jeff Kalman, newest addition to our booth, as it were, and another baseball historian who writes a column called Thronberry Fields Forever. Now, only a Met fan can identify with that. Jeff, if you would introduce yourself to Marty and Robert by telling them about the column that I'm so familiar with. And let us know, Jeff Kalman.
Oh, it's really simple. When I started doing this quite a long time, enough time ago, I happened to be listening to the Beatles' Strawberry Fields Forever at the time, and I had a book dealing with the Mets, I forget which one, on my table next to me, and I put two and two together and came up with Thronberry Fields Forever.
Ingenious. Only a Met fan can know about about that, and you write a very analytical column that oftentimes addresses books that you've read on the particular subject that you're covering. I wanted to talk a little bit about the 1973 New York Mets, and I want to go around the room a little bit and get your memories of 73 in order. Start with you, Robert Cole.
Well, what I remember most is being 26, working in a hardware store, and the Mets having to win at least one of two games, the last game of this last day of the season, which happened to be a Monday. They had to make up a doubleheader against the Cubs. It was miserable, it was raining, it was cold. If they won the first game, they didn't have to play the second game. If they lost the first game, they were going to have to win the second game. And I just remember that very clearly, and the Mets, of course, did win that game and win the pennant. But that was a strange year. Nobody really wanted to win the East that year. 11 games separated the first-place team from the last-place team in that division. And it was just a really strange year, other than Tug McGraw.
You got to believe.
And I think he was the only one.
Right. Well, that was kind of a mocking statement. M. Donald Grunt, or M. Donald Duck, who, however you want to call him, came down to the Mets when they were struggling, came down to the clubhouse, and they were struggling because if not for their injuries,
they wouldn't be struggling. They were devastated early on with both injuries and call-ups to the reserves, if I recall.
You're right about the injuries.
But more about the injuries. I remember Harrelson was hurt for a long time, and they started the season in bad trouble. And what I remember is that the press was so hard on Cashman and Berra that they would, the Post in particular, would publish a daily "Is he still here?" kind of score sheet. You know, it was amazing that Berra kept that team alive, so to speak, and they won it. Marty, your memories of that year?
Well, like Robert said, it's funny. We're about the same age, and that was my first year of 42 at the AP. I started in that year. And,
oh, wow.
So it was a difficult year for me, starting with a new job. But what I remember about that year in particular was that it was so close all year long. Like, no team could really get anything going for a period of time. I think they have 82 wins. They won the division with 82 wins.
Correct.
79.
Yeah.
Yes, three games over 500 wins.
And they did have a lot of injuries. I think Grote only played 84 games. Duffy Dyer played a lot of games. I was at a game that year, late in the season, when Duffy Dyer was coming up in a big spot, and we're all shaking our heads, and he hits a double off the wall. You know, everybody went nuts. It was great. But you know, Milán led the team, hitting .290. It just wasn't a lot of offense. And out of those 82 wins, Seaver won 19 of them. So,
right.
You know, right. And George Stone, who, you know, if I wouldn't have looked it up, I probably may not have remembered George Stone. But he was
and
all
Harry Parker, and Harry Parker coming out of the bullpen as well.
Yeah. So there's a couple of names there that normally you wouldn't associate with the Mets, but they were there that year, and they did a good job.
Very solid guy who Giants fans will cringe when they hear the name, because basically you're looking at Orlando Cepeda.
Ray Sadecki
has a terrific year as a swingman. He started games. He relieved games. He really was solid.
3.39 ERA.
Yeah. Jeff Coleman, memories of 73.
Well, I was a freshman in college at the time. I was just shy of my 18th birthday. And I went to the game against the Expos on September 25th that year. Now, Jerry Kuzman squared off against Steve Rogers. They were scoreless till the bottom of the fifth. Félix Millán hit a one-out sacrifice fly. The Expos tied in the top of the sixth on a scoring error. Mets took the lead back in the bottom when Cleon Jones hit one out. And now, not long afterwards, I found a quote from that game from Yogi Berra. Quote, "The game is 50-50. I remember near the end of the season I replaced Jerry Kuzman with Tug McGraw. I come back to the dugout and a fan says, 'Yogi, did you do right?' I says back, 'Don't know, we'll see in a minute.' Well, McGraw kept it scoreless the rest of the way. The Mets won that game. And what else I remember about that year was what the National League East looked like starting in September. The Mets were 63-71 and 5.5 games back in fifth place. They were dead last 2 days earlier. Now, the rest of September goes like this. The Mets, 20-8. The Cardinals, 13-15. The Pirates, 15-17. The Expos, 16-13. The Cubs, 13-15. The Phillies, 9-19. And the Mets heated up just enough to make it count, especially a seven-game winning streak between the 18th and the 25th. And my personal call on that team, looking back and looking at everything about them, everybody who did what, I have to say the unsung hero was probably Harry Parker.
Whoa.
Yeah, you're right.
A 3.35 ERA out of the bullpen. His fielding independent pitching rate, which is your ERA without your defense, is 3.41. And he had a 1.19 walks and hits per inning pitched rate. He was actually slightly better than Tug McGraw was that year. Harry Parker, I think, is the unsung hero of that team.
Yeah. And another one was Duffy Dyer, the aforementioned Duffy Dyer.
He was bank when Jerry Grote got hurt. I'm trying to remember who got hurt that year. You mentioned Harrelson and Grote. Cleon Jones
some
time on the DL. Rusty Staub, Jon Milner, and Jon Matlack. Those were the key guys who got hurt during that year.
Right. I loved Milner. I thought he was terrific. He kept Crane Poole on the bench. And overall in his career, Crane Poole was a better pinch hitter than anything else.
There's something to be said for a top-of-the-line pinch hitter.
No question. And
in 73, no Met was particularly having a great season among the position players. Rusty Staub was the only regular to have a higher on-base percentage than 350.
Oh, funny. Hey, let me tell you my memories, guys. It was the first and only World Series I ever attended in Oakland. The Mets, it was Game 6. The Mets were going to win Game 6 or for sure lose Game 7, and that's the way it turned out. It was.
And yet those Mets were the only team among the three straight Oakland World Series champions who took the A's to a seventh game.
Oh, very interesting that.
The only seven-game series the A's played in that three-game streak was the
game.
Mets.
Did not pitch well in that sixth game that I witnessed. I also remember Charlie Finley brought in Jack Benny, of all folks, to throw out a pitch, the first pitch in that 76 game. Threw it out from the stands. In those days, when you threw out the first pitch, you didn't get to go to the mound to do it. You never saw Eisenhower or Truman at the mound.
I saw Jack Benny do that on the television broadcast, and for a moment I thought Finley was going to sign into a contract and put him in at second base.
Well, he'd have to send him down to Cucamonga for a little seasoning. If you remember the old Jack Benny show.
Do you remember the hoopla over Mike Andrews in that series?
Yes, it was. And I've had Nancy Finley as a guest on our podcast network a number of times and talking about the bad rap that her uncle Charlie, her dad was Carl Finley. And she wrote a book about those days, and very interesting. The book fascinated me. It talked about that Andrews instance, and a lot of it was just about the Finleys and management in those days being so out of touch. It was the year before free agency, and the players were just hateful of Finley, and that's what brought them together as a team, basically. They hated each other, but once the game started, they played well together between the lines, and it was really a fascinating year, 1973, for a number of reasons. It was fascinating on the Yankee side of baseball in New York. And we'll get into that on another show. But
one of the things I want to do is pay homage to Rusty Staub, who passed away last year. And he was key on that team. And he was probably the most, amongst the five most beloved New York Mets of all time. I mean, you could talk about Seaver, the Glider, Crane Pool, this and that. Staub's right there. So let's go around the horn a little bit one more time. Memories of Rusty Staub, whom I named my dog after. I named my dog Rusty. He was an Irish setter. Not a smart dog.
I thought you'd call him Le Grand Orange.
No, he was just plain Rusty. I had a trouble, as Marty will tell you, I had trouble learning languages.
Espanol, sí.
Espanol, I got 19 in Spanish at Newtown High School. It turned me into a super senior because you couldn't graduate unless your overall average was over 65. And it took me a long time to take shop classes and business machine classes to get over a 65 average. Thank you, Hazel Artis, for that grade. I deserved it, by the way. 19 in Spanish is probably the lowest all-time grade in Newtown history. But aside that, Robert Cole, talk about Rusty Staub.
Oh, well, you pretty much, you know, summed it up. He was just a fan favorite, just a great guy. Nothing really bad you could say about him. Unfortunately, he never got to a championship with the Mets, but he was just a good all-around ball player. I enjoyed watching him.
Good. Marty.
Yeah, he was. He wasn't particularly fast, but he gave 100% all the time. I remember him smashing into the wall in the outfield and hurting himself. That I remember, and which mm-hmm. probably hindered him in the World Series. He had that particular year. He led the team, but he only had 76 RBIs. To show you how weak that team was offensively. You know, Milner had 72. But Rusty just he had that magnetism that you know draws people, and he was just a as we found out later in life, a terrific human being with all the charity work that he did and all that other stuff. So he was a wonderful guy.
Yes. Jeff Common, please, your memories of Rusty.
Well, one of my most outstanding ones is Rusty Staub Day in 1985 when his teammates pranked him by coming out of the dugout wearing these ridiculous-looking cockatoo-layered orange wigs to celebrate him. But I also remember, I think most of all, was that after 9-1-1, it was Rusty Staub who created the New York Police and Fire Widows and Children's Fund.
That's right.
And ramped it up. He created it not long after he retired, but he ramped it up double after 9-1-1. He was sitting in a restaurant after he heard someone was killed on duty. That was why he formed the group. And I think it was a police officer, and left a widow and three children. And Staub said, someone has to do something, and he did. And that group came through big after 9-1-1. So to all credit to Rusty Staub for that group.
Wow. Cannot end this any better than that story. Proud to be a Met fan. Robert Cole, Marty Rose, Jeff Common. This is terrific. We'll do it again real soon. Adios, everybody. Thank you both. Thanks to all three of you for making me comfortably zoned.
Have a good night.
Good night. All right. Good night, guys.